Well, happy Thanksgiving, everyone. What I'm thankful for, looking back, is that those in phase 1, 2, and 3 have not really attacked me or criticized me or made things difficult for me. I'm thankful of that for sure. Very surprising, because what I say from the phase 4 standpoint certainly is very jarring to phase 1, 2, and 3, because from their perspective they have different conclusions. For example, Jesus, the word of Jesus in A Journey Beyond Words, says emphatically that the second coming, when he spoke of that, he's speaking to our thoughts and our imaginings. It's not real, though. It's not real. I get from this, when he talks about a physical second coming, I get from this that there is no physical second coming. Jesus is not coming back in the body, in the flesh, in this world. And of course, that's something that jars, you know, those in the first phase who believe that Jesus is going to come back physically and destroy all the enemies in the world, bad people in the world, and rule over this world physically as a king, you know, and all this. But, you know, I wouldn't ask Jesus to do that. I don't want Jesus to have to identify with a body, a form. He says that he sees this all as golden light, shimmering golden light. That's how he sees us. That's how he sees himself. Why would we want him to try and return as a body? So maybe he says that the second coming of Christ is the ending of time within us, when we realize that the judgment of called time is not necessary. We drop it and we see what we really are, not bound by time at all. And we realize that we are Christ. We are Christ. We are the Son of God. We are spirit. We're not a body. We're free. We are still as spirit as God created us to be. So I read this and I say, wow, Jesus is not returning physically. No, it's not. this is like, wow, real shocker. So maybe I'll get some flack for this, but this is what Jesus is saying, and I get it. Now, I'm sort of having an anxiety attack because I get it. It's very scary. I was reading what Jesus is talking about in Journey Beyond Words, and I understood it. I got it. I say, yeah, I see this. It's like, whoa, I'm not supposed to be able to see this. I mean, are you kidding? So I'm just nervous, really nervous. But this is all about moving one's comfort zone, because what happens is on the path is phase one is you get a vague glimpse or just a brief glimpse of truth, and you say, oh, I get it, for just an instant, and then, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to get that, and you back off. And gradually we move our comfort zone, so we get it more and more and better and clearer, but every time we really see and say, you know what, I can be saved, absolutely, that scares us, for sure. So in other words, we're shocked at how clear we can be, and I saw it better than ever before. I suddenly understood what he's talking about. I said, oh, I don't know if I want to understand it that well. Wow, what's going to happen to me? You know, it's like, that's a fearful thing, so I'm kind of nervous about that. Now, last night I had a very amazing experience. Very amazing. Somehow, I don't know how it happened. Actually, I put in YouTube Dr. Brent Haskell, and I came across some YouTube video. It's some kind of A Course in Miracles in the mountains or something. And there's some introduction. It said, introducing Dr. Brent Haskell. I said, huh? So they showed this introduction, and then they showed Dr. Brent Haskell walking into the room or something. I said, wow. And then just as he's ready to speak, they said, you must go to this website to see more. So I went to this website, and they offer you a download for $35 of the whole this whole speech or talk or sharing, 2 hours. But they had a little excerpt, a video of excerpts of this. And I saw Dr. Brent Haskell speaking. I said, are you kidding me? I've been looking for Dr. Brent Haskell for 20 years. 20 years. Never seen him before. Never seen the body he's moving around. But I could hardly believe my eyes. And, wow. Because this, and it's very funny because the one who introduced him, this lady said, "This Dr. Haskell is the slipperiest person. I mean, he is so slippery. It's so tough to pin down. I mean, you talk," and she says, oh, I see him near the door. Whoa, don't leave yet. Don't leave. You can't leave, you know. And she's joking about how tough it is to get him, you know, to appear anywhere. And she says, "Actually, I have some bodyguards stationed there to make sure he can't escape." And they say, we've been trying to get him to come to these conferences for so long. I mean, what they did was they staged this Miracles in the Mountains thing, ACIM, whatever you want to call it. Sort of a clique of ACIM, what do you call them? I don't know what to say, but they're sort of a clique of those who always show up at these conferences, the same ones. You know, they're supposed to be those who are known, you know, the new bishops of the ACIM or something, I don't know. But they're all there, you know, the same crowd's all there. And they finally got Brent Haskell to come because they staged it in where he lives, in the city that he lives. Very clever on their part. It's pretty hard to say, "Dr. Haskell, all you have to do is drive 2 minutes and you're right there. We're right next door to where you're living." So he actually showed up. I'm not sure he really wanted to. He seems to be the most elusive person in the world. Really. I mean, even the websites on him and forums and what stuff, they say, "I've never seen him. I've never talked to him. Nobody knows where he is. Nobody knows about Dr. The world is the most mysterious man, for sure. And he's the one that received this transmission from Jesus, which is a Journey Beyond Words, which for me is my go-to book. It is my go-to book, for sure. That is, you know, this is absolutely astonishing what Jesus says in there. And right on the money, spot on. So he's talking, and he's just like, whoa. Look at him, he's just like totally uncharismatic and plain and simple, but also super mental. You know, you can see how he's wired. You know, he's thin and sort of wiry and just you know, his mind is working, you know, at a higher level than most, for sure. But super unpretentious, plain, very amazing. You say, wow, this is Dr. Brent Haskell, the one person I've always wanted to meet, you know, so to speak. Now I've seen him, I say, okay, it's no big deal. Yeah, he's... And he's talking about, you know, some of the explanations and Journey Beyond Words. And he has it down as far as what he's saying. But I noticed also that the peace of mind, the great stillness, wasn't there. Not like Ramana Maharshi or something. So that's phase two, phase three. You know, in phase four, we need to go through phase four and get past that. And Ramana Maharshi talks about how there's the great bliss, but he says even beyond that is the great stillness, and that's even higher. And so we have a ways to go here in the West and in the world. But what frightens me is I get it. You know, it's like I understand what Jesus is saying, and it's what's going to happen to me? I mean, you know, we love Ramana Maharshi, but is anyone really willing to be like that? You know, who's willing to be like that, actually? Sri Sri Anandamayi. Sometimes I leave off the ma because she always said, I'm nobody's mother. Don't see me as a mother. Don't see me as a mother. That produces distancing and awe, and that's not what I'm here for, actually. You know, who can be like that? That's what we really need. because this thing, even this conference, Miracles in the Mountains, you know, it's fine. These lovely people, this lovely sort of band and clique of people who, spirits, dear spirits, who are, feel that they're finding a comfort zone with this. And I'm thankful that they haven't attacked me or gotten angry at me or commented or anything. Everybody just left me alone. Nobody's gotten angry, really. Very few, really. Very minimal. So I'm very thankful of that. But it just is what it is. But they, you know, we all have a ways to go. We all have a ways to go, for sure. And it's a continuity problem. It's a continuity problem. Maybe I can go on now because I've seen Dr. Brent Haskell. He's still here, you know, he's just like, wow. For me, you know, brought forth, for him to be able to hear what he heard and to be willing to receive the transmission and then publish it, you know, put his name on it and stuff is quite astonishing, actually. Quite astonishing. Because the transmission is so incredibly advanced. Yeah, amazing. So, and maybe he just doesn't want to, you know, he doesn't want to doesn't want to take credit for it, and he doesn't want to make people make a big deal about him or anything like that, and it's just super low-key and just basically doesn't, not into any of the glamour or the glitz or the, you know, all the stuff of the spiritual path, look at me, I'm very spiritual or anything. No, he's on a different level, sort of. He doesn't want to be found. He doesn't want anybody knocking on his door, really. That's fine. That's his style. So the book speaks for itself. He's not getting in the way of the book. He's never gotten in the way of the book. He's never gotten in the way of Jesus, you know, which is quite astonishing. To be very commended, actually, for what he's done. That's his role. He's doing his role beautifully. So we have the teachings, we have the book, and if we can understand what Jesus is saying, it just is a stunner. It is a stunner. So wherever you are in the path, don't think that you finished, that you know it all. That keep challenging yourself. Try to understand what Jesus says in Journey Beyond Words. And I've been trying for 20 years. After 15 years of A Course in Miracles. So actually I've been trying, most of that, yeah. It's just keep trying and keep trying and keep trying. Every time you try, it's scary because you see more and more and more. And you say, well, what's going on? I'm getting closer to having the mind of Jesus, being one with the mind of Jesus. I'm agreeing with all this and saying, yeah. Talking about time and judgment and working, how all of this is just a result of working with time. And I saw the whole thing. I was able to, you know, view it from the standpoint of Jesus' mind, how he was looking at it like that. And I said, wow, okay, yeah. Wow, I see what you're saying. That this world is all a result of us working with this notion of judgment, of time, and explaining what time is. So it's understandable. He's spot on about this. Our minds are capable of seeing this. So we just have to keep working, and these clarifications will dawn upon us. But then the backlash comes, and you just say, oh, wow. I don't want to step out of humanity that far. Who can step out like Ramana Maharshi stepped out of humanity like that? Who can do that, you know? Just astonishing, astonishing, astonishing. We thought we could back in the 60s, but things have changed so much now. I mean, I'm still living on the idealism of the 60s. in the 70s and trying to keep hold of that, but I'm telling you, it's really difficult because the way that things have changed. We're running out of time, for sure, running out of time. Would anyone even understand the silence of a Ramana? So it's hard to say what the next step will be for any of us, isn't it? It really is. So I don't know what will happen next. I mean, I saw Dr. Brent Haskell after 20 years of trying to find out something about him. Well, where is he? How could you see him? What's he like? What, you know? How come he's a recluse, you know? Protects his privacy, you know, very strongly. So that happened. So maybe something else will happen. If I can handle that, maybe something else will happen. But imagine if Jesus, for instance, were to come to you and speak to you or somehow and say, guess what, I'm not coming back. I'm not coming back to this world. I mean, that just, you know, would be a stunner. I think people are kind of afraid to talk with Jesus, actually. Really, especially those in the first phase. Of course, those who have not even started don't believe it at all, so they would never even say they are talking with Jesus. It's not possible. They say never existed, they think so. But the first phasers realize, yeah, there is a Jesus, and he's alive today. Jesus lives today. Jesus saves today. But they don't really want to converse with him because he might say something that is contrary to their, you know, teachings and beliefs, traditions. They're scared, you know, scared. What if they said, guess what, I'm not coming back? What? You know, they based their whole, you know, so much of their belief that Jesus is returning to this world. Now, I'm not saying that there won't be some sort of rapture or we might possibly go to a dwelling place he's prepared. That's what he said he'd do. He didn't say he was going to come back and rule over this world. I don't know who said that. Jesus never said that. So where that came from is interesting. It's probably just a hope for those who are too frightened to think that this world is their home, that their bodies are their identity. They're hoping that Jesus can make them feel good about that, you know, but now we have to change that belief. That's what we have to do. So for me, there's so much up in the air right now. There's just so many threads of tapestry is just so full. I don't know what the threads are going to weave. It's like there's this loom that is, you know, just shuttling back and forth, going so fast. And I don't know what the pattern is going to be as the cloth, you know, is formed in the loom. And there's so many super interesting colors of threads and textures of the threads going into this. I said, wow, something quite incredible, well, not something quite amazing is likely to appear on this cloth. My, you know, the tapestry of my cloth is likely to take on some pretty astonishing characteristics. And the loom just keeps going, and I'm just sitting there watching the cloth as it feeds out the loom. As it's spooling off the loom, and you just say, oh, wow. But you don't really know, right? So many threads, and everything's going so fast, and how do you know how it's all going to be woven together? star of superstars. And just to see him and just how ordinary he was and unaffected, and it's just wow. He's just a normal guy, you know, just a normal guy. In most respects. He's just living in the world. He can walk, he can talk, he can... So, yeah, it's very liberating, very liberating, very liberating. So there must be something to that. There must be some reason that I suddenly came across him, you know. Just something popped into my mind. Just, you know, search for Dr. Brent Haskell on YouTube. And there was this recently uploaded, I believe, way to see. Wow. The insights that are coming are so profound that I just, I'm just noticing them and just saying, wow, okay. Not really thinking about them. The key about, there's something there, strong insights is don't think about them. Just let the self-evidency of it and see what you saw. Just let that be there. Don't struggle. Full stop. Don't think about it. Don't add thoughts to it. Don't try to transpose it into thought, okay, into thinking. Don't transpose it into thinking. Because all truth is completely self-evident. It doesn't have to have any thoughts or thinking about it. Now, the one insight today was, whatever is not here now is never here now. What is here now, actually? There's only here nowness. It was along those lines. And it registered. So thinking about it isn't going to really do it any good. In fact, it confuses the issue, putting all sorts of words on it. But I'm just saying, I realized that. I just said, wow, yeah. So these insights I'm having are like fundamental, you know, core, high spiritual insights. And just... a lot of them are coming now. I'm just saying, okay. So it's great. No one's really bothered me. None of the groups, even corporations, haven't come after me. Politicians haven't come after me. Various religions haven't come after me. Atheists haven't come after me. And nobody, none of these groupings, you know, none of these beliefs have come after me. Maybe they're saying, hey, you know, maybe this will help us. Because certainly, the only way you can be saved is to see everybody else saved first. The only way you can be happy is to see is to extend happiness to everyone, to all, without exception. And since you're part of the all, it's extended to yourself too. You're part of that, but you must extend it to the all, without any exception whatsoever. This is what Jesus tells us. This is the core key truth. No exceptions. Otherwise, you won't have the happiness. You will not. You'll have a concept of it. It'll be in time. it won't be now. Because truth is true now. Okay, truth is true right now. So as I've always said, what we fear is success. All right, we come here to fail. We all want to be. We think the failure is success because it keeps us away from success, which we're frightened of. Very frightened of it. So in studying the great transmissions, if you start getting it, you know, you say, "Oh wow, I'm being too successful here. I better back away from this. I better confuse myself." And that's what we do. And so we intentionally throw ourselves into all sorts of confusion and distraction just to, you know, take the edge off the success we're having, because it's a very intimidating experience to when you realize that you're capable of understanding what Jesus understands, knowing what Jesus knows. You're capable of it. Your mind is capable of it. And it's, what's going to happen to me then, you see? And, you know, when Jesus says he indicates he's not returning as a body, it seems to indicate that he was just speaking to our thoughts and imaginings. It didn't really mean that, you know, he's returning physically here. Well, all those in the world who claim they are Jesus, that, you know, that must not go over too well with them. And there's plenty of those saying that. And for some reason, they want to play that game. That's fine. But we should look for Jesus as spirit and truth, which is what he says. God created us as spirit and truth, not as bodies. Spirit and truth. So his return in spirit and in truth. That's not to say he can't have an appearance of some sort. Sure, that's possible. But as far as coming back to this world and walking upon this world, you know, like, you know, getting a birth and come, doesn't seem like that's going to happen. Now, I know a lot of us have been hoping that would happen if one of these great, you know, great sages, great saviors would be reborn, come back to this world and be here, but it doesn't seem like that's going to happen. So we have to be the saviors. You know, we have to accept what they're saying and realize, you know, that we are it. We are it. All of us are it right now. So, I guess earlier on I would have had a hard time accepting this, but finally I accepted, like, well, maybe he's not coming back. You know, it's a tough one to accept, for sure. I say maybe because he's free to do whatever he wants to do. We're all free. So, I won't say never, but it seems as though. So what about, you know, what about what the future then, right? How do we look at the future here? Again, that tapestry is being woven, the tapestry, the loom is weaving this tapestry. So, have to see what it looks like tomorrow. Could very well be something, you know. In my case, I would say, that I just have to get used to. I've got all eternity to get used to it, so that shouldn't be that much of a problem. But if Dr. Brent Haskell can keep it together, then I should be able to. You know, others should be able to. I mean, I can certainly understand what's being said. It doesn't bother me at all, really. Again, what bothers me is that I do get it. That's what bothers me. Not that I don't, but that I do get it. Because it said, wow, what does that mean? You know, what does that mean? When you but Dr. Haskell's just, you know, plain, ordinary, walk past you on the sidewalk, you wouldn't notice anything. He seems very youthful though, very youthful. very young in mind, very fresh in his mind. So, yeah, for some reason, I'm not part of that ACAM clique of people, of spirits, which is fine. Just fine. You know, they're having their roles. I'm having my role, whatever that is. But we could use some sort of, you know, enrichment of the whole scene in this world. Put a little salt on the potatoes or something, you know. A little gravy, maybe. How's Thanksgiving? Maybe we put some gravy on the potatoes. A new song, you know. If you know, listening to music, you realize that music's always changing. I wouldn't say it's evolving, it's changing. It is, and it's like there's different styles that get added, and one day you're listening to something and you say, wow, what is this? I never heard this before. But it sort of adds to the overall palette of the situation, right? So we shouldn't expect that everybody, you know, that studied ACIM is going to be, you know, part of the HCMers that go to these conferences and stuff. You shouldn't expect that. I mean, even Dr. Haskell, they couldn't hardly get him to come to it. So it's different. There's a lot of people on the spiritual path, pilgrims, who will have different expressions, you know, sing the song a little differently. Look at Ramana Maharshi, how he sang the song. Sri Sri Anandamayi, like how she sang the song. Yeah, it will be different. We won't be the same as that. Not exactly the same. Different styles and times, etc. Right? So. I'm sort of in this phase, like, uh-oh, I get it. In other words, if the realization came, I would get it. You know, I get it. I'm simpatico with it. I'm aligned with it now. So, oh, that's trouble. You know, the old saying, the Christians say, Jesus, please come. We need you. You got to return. Please come. But not quite yet. Not today. Tomorrow. It's like that. So, you know, we're nervous. Everybody says, oh, sure, Jesus is coming back. We've been 5 years. It should be about 5 years from now or something. It's always a distance. And Jesus ultimately is not coming back because he never left. He's always here. He's here now. Never came in the first place, never left. Always present. Truth, God is always present. We are in God right now, as a matter of fact. This realization could dawn, there's no question about it. Then I just have to say, uh-oh, now I'm really in for it. Yeah, well, only got, what, 20-some-odd years to live, maybe, or something, so, you know, might as well put up with some foolishness, I don't know, how, you know, people react, you never know. Everybody's a little cuckoo in this world, as a matter of fact. Everyone's a little cuckoo. Some a lot, actually. But that's how it is, absolutely. Because the thing is again, we fear success. So what do? We come up short. We stop. We say, well, that's close. I can't go any further. Too close. That's enough. And then when we stop, then we have to defend our stopping. You know, because we don't want anybody else to go further, because that means we stopped, we didn't finish. So we want to say, no, this is it, this is finished, this is, and so we defend our, we rationalize and defend our stopping. And then we begin persecuting those who've gone on further, because it threatens us, feel very threatened. So everybody is stopped somewhere. Those who can handle the situation are those who are constantly moving their comfort zone, so they're not stagnated and stopped and defending their position of having stopped. So those who have stopped become very defensive about their stopping because they feel guilty, something wrong with them, so they got to defend it and attack anybody who suggests that they should go further, you know. So those who are working every day to move their comfort zone, they can handle somebody saying that they've gone on further or something. It's not a problem. They say, okay, not a problem. I'm so used to the flexibility of every day moving my comfort zone, the whole landscape shifting every day. They say, well, okay, that's no problem. I'll just, you know, eventually I'll get there too. So they're not defending anything, not defending any position. Like, well, what position can I defend, really? Because tomorrow, you know, the landscape may shift again. Probably will. Shifts every day. Every day it shifts. So I say, okay, whatever. I don't know how this tapestry is going to turn out, but I'll just see what it is. Just see what it is and get used to it. So basically, you know, it's just a matter of getting used to it. Just keep getting used to it. So those are the ones that, you know, will benefit. And those who have an entrenched position, thinking that that stopping where they stop, they don't want to go any further, and then they have to defend this stopping, they get very defensive about it. You know, they'll have some trouble probably. Probably just ignore it, you know, just ignore realization. They just say, nah, I don't want to go any further. But the key to going further is everyday practice. There's no way around it. No way around it. Shift your comfort zone. Move your comfort zone. Shift the landscape. Morph the landscape. You look at it and say, wow, that landscape's different than yesterday. I'm seeing everything a little bit differently now. This is a different, you know, the scenario is different. It changes, changes, changes. That's the only way to work on this continuity fear and the problem of familiarity. It's the only way. You can't just sit down one day and say, okay, intellectually I'm going to just get it that way, you know, because familiarity requires this gradualness sort of getting used to it. It's the right use of time. Working on familiarity with truth is the right use of time. Right use of mind, right use of time. So whatever questions you have today, tomorrow you may not have them, you see. Tomorrow you may not have them. As far as asking questions, etc., you'll never get the answers unless you practice every day and move your comfort zone. You'll never get the answers you want. Never. So, but if you do practice every day, move your comfort zone, full stop in the now, don't get into your thoughts or thinking about it. Just absorb it with it, deep within, beyond your struggling and your analyzing and your strategizing and all that. Just let it be, and just get used to it. Then all your questions will be answered eventually, for sure. That's the only way. So instead of expecting someone to answer questions, your questions, you know, expect them to say, practice more. Just practice. Keep practicing and you'll get it. Keep practicing and you'll get it. I'm reminded like a guitar teacher said, someone comes in, I remember I used to say, hey, could you just, I don't want lessons, can you just show me how to play this particular lick, you know, this is really great, I just want to know how to play that, just show me. And so they say, well, and they say, no, if you have to learn this and this and this and this, and eventually you'll know how to play it, you know. I said, no, I just just show me, there's some trick to it, I think I can get it. It's like that, I was like that. Same thing with the piano, but it's only the ones who get all the basics and are just so solid through and through and through with their picking, with their fretting, just everything is just, you know, second nature to them. The stamina of their you know, of their fingers and so much. Gradually that all coalesces into just being able to do it. So remember, the answers have to be seen as self-evident and accepted as self-evident. And that's the frightening part. There's no learning needed, no thinking needed, nothing to be added to it at all. And the answer as to how to cure all problems, just hold on to the no problem state. How to fix all lies, just hold on to truth. Holding on to truth is getting rid of all lies. It's the end of all lies. And so this is what has to dawn. This is what has to dawn. So we have to continue to practice. That's the only way. It's frustrating because almost everyone that goes and wants lessons, they just want to be able to seem to be really flashy and like play this, you know, just this lick, you know, just like Mary goes, wow, you, that's really hot lick there. You, this is great. Really, they want to, you know, make that splash. And very few want to actually be the master of the instrument, you know, and just be able to completely just do whatever they want to do. You know, that's a nice feeling for sure. You just say, I can play anything, not a problem. Very few are like that. But those are the ones that will succeed. So nothing succeeds like practice. Nothing succeeds like familiarity. There's no shortcut to it. So you just have to do it. Again, hearing the good news. And hearing it more, better and better and better until you realize, wow, I just really heard that. Deep down, you heard it through and through. Your spirit heard it and responds. Then you know when your spirit's responding, it hears it. Says, yeah. And then they say, oh, wow, that's scary. What am I going to be like? Something's going to. But again, that's again just a comfort zone thing. Familiarity is whatever it is. You just have to get familiar with it and tell everybody the same thing. It's just a matter of familiarity. There's no secret or trick about it, actually. How can someone play the piano that way? Well, they've done scales hundreds of thousands of times, you know, and worked on it more and better and better and better and better and better and better and better, you know. And so they can do any scale just effortlessly without even looking or thinking about it. It's all just wired into them now. So just practice. Intelligent practice. And not just robotic, but very intelligent practice. Like, okay, how am I doing? Do I need to keep doing this just over and over, or do I have it already? And then practice and see if you can go to it just as a go-to thing, or do you have to think about it and keep working so it's just automatically go-to without thinking about it? It's like that. Practice is like that. And so those of you who have practice on something really understand what practice is all about. Now, one of the reasons probably I've been able to go on this path, this difficult path, is because of previous life. I was a practice-aholic, you know, with music and the piano. So my entire life, I was playing, practicing constantly. So I understood, you know, the value of practice in what you're up against. And so I just applied that to the spiritual path. So I was just naturally geared towards practicing. I would sit in my room and practice the guitar 10 hours a day, a lot of days. Like weekends, just all day. And before school, I went to school. After school, piano, the same thing. Singing, I've done that. Whatever I've done, I'm able to just practice. So this is what works. Unless you want to be a dilettante, but on the spiritual path you can't afford to be a dilettante. This is very important. You can be a dilettante in everything else in the world, but you cannot be a dilettante on the spiritual path. Cannot. Because you'll end up becoming defensive, defending your lack of progress, defending your stuckness, and demanding that everybody else be stuck there with you. So this is the problem in the world right now. So many people are super stuck. And they're demanding that everybody be stuck. And nobody go further than they have gone. And that you get to rule the mob this way. Okay, this is why you have troubles in the world right now. It's those who are stuck and don't want to go any further. They insist that everybody else be stuck with them and share their confusion. And because if they feel uncomfortable with those who are not so confused, you know, they feel threatened and frightened. They say, oh, I can't go any further. I gotta stay where I am. It's not fair that those have gone further. I want everybody to come back here and be stuck, you know. This is the ideology of the world that's gaining so much traction, which is a terrible thing, actually. This is the horrible trend in a lot of ways in this world. Lowest common denominator. It's not fair for you to go further. If somebody else decides they want to stop and they want to go any further, that somehow you're supposed to stop too and regress or something? What is that? Some kind of universal law? No, there's no such law. We're all free. So, we're under no obligation to stop. Those who are stopping are still thinking, hey, maybe I can get an exemption or exception, maybe I can change God. So they're still into that. That's their right that they want to be that way, but they have no right to, you know. Well, they can insist or demand that we stop, but we can also insist and demand that we not stop. And God upholds the one who claims freedom. Okay, God upholds freedom. For those who claim that others cannot be free just because they're pretending not to be free, then the nature of reality does not uphold that. See? But it also is true that, for instance, I cannot demand that others be enlightened because they're free to not be. I can't demand that everyone practice because they're free to be lazy and waste their time. They're free to do that, and reality upholds their freedom to do that. Absolutely it does. But it also upholds my freedom to practice. So, the anxiety continues. There's something strong going on. I feel like the way that the tapestry is going to be woven coming off that loom very soon is going to be quite something for sure. So that's great. So just keep watching your loom, the tapestry that's coming off your loom, and just pay attention to it, and just get used to it. Because when you do that, God will start weaving into your tapestry more and more epiphanies, more and more miracles, more and more breakthroughs. And this is how it goes. This is how it takes place. The more attention you put on it, the more you practice getting used to it, the more these miracles are woven into the very fabric of your tapestry, of your experiencing. And seeing Dr. Brent Haskell was quite a miracle, I'll tell you that. I never thought it would ever happen. Never thought that would happen. Really did not. I'd given up, basically. If something prompted me, I always been searching on Google, Dr. Brent Haskell, any news about Doc? Never. hardly ever, you know. Oh, he's scheduled to appear. Oh, he appeared in San Jose, 10 years ago. Wow, yeah. He flies under the radar. He really flies under the radar. So I just said, never going to happen. But it happened. So, you see, who knows what thread God will put into your tapestry. But you must pay attention to it. Be ready. Have the poise, which is what we practice here. We practice spiritual poise. Very important full stop in the now, full stop in the wow, full stop in the burn. Very important. It's getting cold outside these nights now, so it's getting harder to tape. I've got to convince myself to come out here and freeze. Excuses, no exceptions, no exemptions. We all have to make it, as Jesus says. We will. We have no choice. We will. The return of Christ is a realization that we are Christ, that we are all one, we are all spirit. And everyone will realize that, so that it will happen, Jesus says. It absolutely will happen. Over this, we have no choice. So, might as well set our sails in that direction and just, you know, keep sailing in that direction and just keep paying attention and keep staying away from bad habits and keep prevent yourself from jumping into too much confusion, prevent too much backlash from happening, keep your poise. Don't jump into thoughts or scenarios or storylines. All truth is self-evident. And just keep your awareness on how your tapestry is coming off that loom. Just be aware of it. Just be aware of it. Okay. Happy Thanksgiving to everyone and those who don't get celebrated. I tend to not celebrate any holidays at all. It, to me, it's all meaningless. Because you have to practice same as the tomorrow, yesterday. Same focus, same discipline, same practice. You can't take a day off. You can't say, hey, this is Thanksgiving, I'm just going to take a day off. There's no way. You can't do that. You don't want to lose momentum. You don't want to waste a day. Got to keep on intensely. No off days, no vacation days. Because the world and its lack of discernment and its demand that you arrest your development. You know, the world's in arrested development. Most people in this world, someplace today waiting, and there's a television on there, and there's some show, you know, afternoon show, and so, just, wow, talk about arrested development, and everyone in the audience is like, you know, just acting like this. All these people have such arrested development, it's incredible, and yet this is what's marketed to the world, of course. The big, really big business alliance wants us all to have arrested development. They want us to be sheeple. Wow, that's what they want, that's what they're getting, that's what they keep showing us on television, to be like this. You can get on a television show if you're like, you know, arrested development. You might be able to, you know, tell your story. This is my story of arrested development. Everyone says, wah! You know. Cameras go on, everyone starts shrieking. You know, arrested development. And this is what's being championed. This is what's being marketed to the world. You know. And the hard alcohol advertising is off the charts now, which helps arrest your development, of course. So all that stuff that's being marketed in the world is designed to arrest your development, to undermine your spiritual discernment, and tell you that this is the, you win. You're a winner. Winning. At least all these people with severe arrested development, and they say, winning, you know, I'm winning. Strung out on drugs, I'm winning. This is winning, folks. This is winning. And people eat that up. So, yeah, well, I'm winning too. This is great. I'm really winning. That's, you know, that's how we've been brainwashing and thinking that we reach the goal of being, you know, the sheeple. We win. We win. What do we win? And there are people, I don't know what we win, but we just win. We reach the goal. How could, that's the win. To be have arrested development. And I guess what you'd say is they feel like protected from success, which in this crazy upside down belief system we have, we call that success. To be protected from success, is winning. You know, and the ones that go all the way, you know, they're losers. Oh, they really lost. They didn't have the capacity, the skill to not succeed, to fail. They didn't have the technique of failure. What a pity, you know, they say, what a pity. They didn't have that, they were lacking that gene, you know, to fail, the failure gene. That's what they're working on in this world frantically. They're looking for the failure gene, you know, so they can make sure they can splice it into everybody really nicely. Protect us from ourselves. Protect us from our perfection, from the one perfection, from the allness. All is all, all in all. Yeah. So the world is a good little, you know, sheep pen. All the sheep are here and celebrating their rest of development. But meanwhile, the rest of us who want, you know, are feeling the pressure to like call it quits, you know, say, well, I better not, you know. I don't want to embarrass the sheep will think of it to show that they've stopped. You see, they don't want any comparison. They don't want to see somebody who's gone further because they'll suffer by comparison, right? It'll become evident that they've stopped in arrested development. So that's why they get very defensive and they feel, you know, antagonistic towards any comparison. Oh, I don't want to be compared. You know, I don't want anybody. So they don't want that. They don't want it. And so that the pressure on us is to not, you know, appear to be too outstanding, because then they'll suffer by comparison. This is the trouble in a world that doesn't keep up their spiritual practice. This is what happens, is the whole thing sinks. Again, if you're doing spiritual practice every day, you're not bothered by those who have gone on further. Like if you're practicing the piano really good every day, you're not bothered by the virtuosos. You say, well, I understand, they probably did the same thing I did, so that, you know, I'm on that path, that's fine. That doesn't bother me. But when you stop practicing, you're lazy and you're rested development, then you feel very threatened by those who are going on because you suffer by comparison. So if you have a whole world that is stopping their spiritual practicing every day, which is what's happened, it's astonishing what's happened. Most people don't even pray anymore, don't pray before meals, don't pray before trips, don't pray now, don't pray this. It's gone evaporated out of our culture for the most part. Then their development's arrested and they expect everybody else to follow suit. And this is what we're getting. The New World Order is arrested development, actually. That's the goal. Everybody will get commendations for it. Good citizens, commendable citizens, praiseworthy. It's some quite something, isn't it? So again, the real remedy for the world's problems is practice every day, spiritual practice every day. Try to bring it into your life as much as possible. It's getting brutally difficult, brutally difficult. We can still do it. We can still do it. We can still do it. The Holy Spirit's with us, so I'm still doing it. And those who are doing it have flexibility. They welcome those who have gone further. They welcome them. They say, wonderful, great. This is something to motivate me. Help me keep going. Help my practicing keep going. You know, if you see someone just playing great, you say, wow, so that's what's possible. Now I'm going to practice some more, you know. This is great. I love to hear these virtuosos. Let me practice more. And those who are lazy, you just say, ah, I can never do that. Forget it. You know, it's ridiculous. I'm going to quit. So there have been some spiritual virtuosos in the world, and it's wonderful to come across them. I pray every day that I come across them. That's what I really want. It's like, wow. And the ones that have gone, I say, come back, come back, come back, come back. Yeah, we need you here, but they don't seem to come back. Can't blame them. Once is enough. Coming here in this world is enough. So somehow, something has to happen. I don't know what, but we'll see. All right. Very great. Have a happy Thanksgiving day. And don't forget your spiritual practice. And give thanks to all the spiritual virtuosos who have been here. And all the motivation we have to practice. Because this is the way to salvation. And you will reach salvation for sure. Everyone will. So you might as well do it sooner than later. Okay. Very great.